Yeah, so I don't have a lot more to add than what we've covered so far for functions. I think both Brian and Arthur did a good job of covering functions chapters so far. What I wanted to go over today was part of the functions chapter and just focus on the infix operators. So I can go ahead and share my screen. Let's see if this works. Can you see the PowerPoint?
I saw it for a minute, then disappeared to me.
Okay, let me try something else. Let me just share the desktop.
Okay.
Okay, so I wanted to just dive a little deeper into the infix functions. The advanced R book goes into it a little bit. Wanted to just take a closer look into what these are. Okay, so R comes with, it already comes with a set of infix operators that you don't have to import or write yourself. A lot of these are what you're used to, or I'm assuming that you know a lot of these. So if we go through, actually, are there any of these that you're like, I'm not sure what that means, or haven't seen it or used it before?
So I'm not too sure about the three colons, and I've used the walrus operator, but I'm not too sure about like the right usage of it, I guess.
Okay. Yeah, I wasn't. The three colons was definitely something that I wasn't as familiar with. But the both the two colons and three colons are for accessing exported and internal variables, or R objects in a namespace, and then it says the two colons returns the value of the exported variable name in the namespace package. And for three colons, it returns the value of the internal variable name. When I looked at the help of that, it said that three colons is used a lot for like package development or development work. So maybe that's why it's not as familiar with some of the other R infix operators. So just continuing going down, the just one colon for generating sequences, like 1 to 10, and it will generate a sequence between those two numbers. The dollar sign and at are for extracting values or parts of an object. The at is specifically for S4 objects. It's called the slot op as well. Then we have basic math infix operators, followed by logical operators, greater than, less than, equal to, not equal to, not. What I thought was interesting is I wasn't as familiar with the double and or the double vertical lines. The double vertical, so the longer forms evaluate left to right and it examines only the first element of each vector. And it said it was appropriate for programming control flow or using it like with if clauses. So that's, again, more of a developer infix operator. And then these last two lines, this is used for this tilde is used for models. And then we have the assignment operator, and then I guess the double arrow assignment operator. And that's normally used in functions. And it causes a search to be made through the parent environments for an existing definition of the variable being assigned. If the variable is found and not locked, it changes. Otherwise, assignment is in a global environment. So I'm sure we'll be digging a little bit more into that double arrow assignment operator, especially next chapter when we get into environments. And then the next one, so we also have the base infix functions with the percent signs. I guess as a little quiz, can anyone say what this first one is?
I'm not sure, but this I don't use that very much, but it's like to calculate the remaining part of when you divide it to quantities.
Modulus, you mean?
Yeah, modulus. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I always forget.
I only like, in operator, so I don't know the others.
You don't know the others?
Yeah, I only use in, and I use in a lot, but others, not too sure. O and X seem very interesting.
So this third one, this infix function is similar to the module. It deals with integer division. And if I can bring over an R session, I can show those really quick. If this lets me. Yeah, so. Let me know if I should increase the screen size or anything. But so for example, the modulo, which you talked about, shows the remainder that's left over. And then integer division, it's basically like division, but it keeps it to the rounded whole number. So those can be, I guess, useful for certain math functions, or if you're programming certain functions or development. Besides the N1, I wasn't as familiar with these other three. The one with the star is actually matrix multiplication. So that's probably why I don't deal with that as much. The one with the O is outer product of arrays. So more like matrix manipulation. And then the one with the X is the Kronecker product of arrays. So that is also like, these three are all like matrix linear algebra related. And I probably would know more about those things if it wasn't so long since my last linear algebra class?
So in, I can explain. So at least in my use cases, I've used it for searching. So when, you know, you want to map, like, you know, you want to filter for something and, you know, compare more than one string values, and you would say, let's say name in, and you create a vector saying, for, let's say, first name in Federica, Priyanka, Trevin. So you, this would be your vector. And so anything in your first name column matches with these three values, that's what you would be filtering. Or, you know, obviously you could reverse that as well. So that's basically how I use this operator, and in many different ways. And I think it applies in SQL as well. Same logic works. O and X I've never used or even encountered. I've never seen them before.
Yeah, I think those other ones are a lot less common. Yeah, I think you can use in with numeric values as well.
Sounds good.
So yeah, that's an overview of the basic infix operators. Now, where the fun part comes in is you can actually like code your own, and there was a good overview of this by Colin Fay, R and Shiny developer. So he kind of went over, you know, what are infix operators. So normally we're used to writing functions in this manner, where it's function, some variables, and then do stuff. And then we call it in this way. But if you only have two operators, this might make sense to use or create your own infix function. So instead of calling it like this, you just use it like you would one of the base R infix operators. So like he was like, whoa to that. And when I saw that you could create your own infix operators, that was like my same reaction. So two things, the infix operators require backticks, since they're special characters, but you can put any characters between the percentage signs, even emojis, as he'll represent later. And then it's surrounded by the two percentage signs surrounding the function name are necessary if you want to create your own infix functions. As it's a special character, you need to use it inside backticks. Note that basic infix functions in R don't need the percent sign, but user-generated one do. I also thought this was really interesting, was that a basic infix function can be operated like a regular function, creating a list between 1 and 10, or adding two numbers. I thought that was like really neat, and so I like played around with that and thought, I'm not sure why. Maybe there's a reason why you would use it. But I thought that was pretty cool. And then he also said you can override these infix operators for whatever reason, if you want to mess around with someone, but probably not recommended. So if you like switch the plus function to instead be a multiplier. You can really confuse your coworker or your future self. So yeah, that also shows the idea of the primitive functions as well, that you can edit those, but probably not recommended. So he goes into a few examples, like if you want to print out the time, the current time, and wait 3 seconds, you can create your own await infix function. And you can also rewrite some of the tidyverse to make it into an infix style. Here he takes select and makes it into an infix function. And then he also discovered that you can use emoji between the percent signs to create your own fun infix function. I saw there was a chat. Sorry about that. Is the pipe an infix function? That's a good question. It might be. Let me. Let me check. Here we go. Pipe. I suppose that, yeah, I would say that the pipe is definitely an infix function. That's a good call. I'm not sure about the new pipe though. That would be like a good question to like research, because the new pipe is, well, mine's a triangle, but it's the vertical line and an arrow, or vertical line and the caret operator. So yeah, he had fun and said if someone has time, they could recode the whole tidyverse using emoji. But just to like go a little bit further, like it's a really useful concept if you have these functions that you only need, two variables with. I know in Colin's Golem package, I think he includes an infix operator not in. So maybe I can find that here. So we have in, but we don't have an equivalent infix function for the opposite. So in his Golem package, he creates one for your benefit and basically just negates the in function. And there's a few more examples like that, but that really opened my eyes to what the infix functions can do and like where you can go from there. Any questions or like, I'm not sure if maybe you have examples of your own infix functions, but yeah, I thought that was pretty fun.
Yeah, very interesting. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Trevin. I feel like I've taken the red pill on the tricks. I see the world in a whole new way now.
I thought Ryan was unmuted and said something. The only other example I can think of off the top of my head is like I have an infix function that basically takes two values, and if the first one's like null or missing, it takes the second value. So just stuff like that can make your coding and development a little easier and a little easier to read.
Can you put the calling blog on the in the chat, please? The link.
The link for what?
For Tinker, blogger, calling.
Oh yeah, yeah. I can. That's a good idea. Here's the link to the blog that I just showed. And yeah, I'm sure there's a lot of other great content in there besides infix functions for your perusal. But yeah, any questions or comments or on the infix?
Well, thanks. That was a really helpful presentation, Trevin.
Thank you. Yeah, if there's nothing else, Federica, I don't know if you want to say anything else, but I think we're off next week, and then I'm presenting on environments the week after.
The next session will be you, and then we jump the following week, because of the conference. But that's fine. Okay, so thank you very much, because you know, simple things sometimes you don't stop by and think, don't spend much time to thinking about these things, and which are very important. Then now that we know, we might possibly use them somehow. Okay, so I have something to share with you as well. So let me see if I can share my screen. Okay, so what I wanted to talk about is a case study, or something which is very similar to a case study, is the SIR model function. The function for making a model for the susceptible, infected, and recovered for infectious diseases. So I found this course on Coursera very, very interesting. This is our specialization, so our three courses, but all of them uses this function as a baseline, and then they do more. Okay, but we stop on just on the basics, just to start, because there's quite a few lines which are very interesting. I won't be using this library, so maybe we'll talk another day about this. The library that we need are dsolve and reshape2, and these two libraries provides a couple of functions which are very interesting. And so we use them to dig inside them and see what is inside, what can be seen, what cannot be seen. So basically this model is composed of some parts which are very important, and they are parameters as well as components of the model. So we very simple and straightforward. Let's imagine we have a population, of 10,000, 100,000 people. Let's imagine that we start our investigation on this illness, on this virus, because it started with the one infected. So all the others are susceptible, and afterward they will become recovered. So we start with a population, a certain number of susceptibles, the infected and the recovered. Then we need to think about the parameters, which are the infection rates, and this is beta, the recovery rates, which is gamma. And those are expressed in terms of days, in reverse. So like, if you get infected within 2 days, so the rate, the infection rate would be 1/2. So in days powered -1, and as well as the recovery rate. So if you recovered from this virus within 4 days, 1/4 would be gamma, so the recovery rate. So having set these parameters, so we have a population, we have a certain number of people, which are the susceptibles, and they are all the population -1, because 1 is the infected one. And then 0 at the starting point are the recovered. So after this, we need to set the time. So this is an important factor, and this defines the length of time within we are looking at this infections, and it's intended as the time range. Okay, so let's imagine that we are investigating this infectious disease spreading over a period of 100 days. Okay, so we set the time as between 0 and 100. Okay, so, and here is the function. Okay, so with all our parameters, we can set up a model function. How do we do that? Is passing the parameters through a function of time and state. Okay, and within this model function, we have one more parameter that will be building up within the function, which is the force of infection. Okay, so how is this function made? And then I have a question for you all. Okay, so if you have an idea, how can we put this function better, make it better, put it in a way that works, releasing the same output, but is made differently. So basically we have a function, which is a function of the time, the state, and the parameters. Now we haven't talked about the state, yes, but we talk in a minute. And then width, this is, do you all know about the width function? Do you? Yeah? Okay. So with as list, we collect the state and the parameters, and then this is the core of the function. So the population, so our our population is composed by the three elements, susceptible, infected, and recovered. It starts like that. Then the lambda starting building up itself as the beta, the infection rate multiplied for the proportion of the infected. And then we have these three differential equations, which is how the susceptible change the number of susceptible changes within our time frame. So that will be decreasing by lambda times the number of susceptibles, while the infected will be increasing by the same amount, but decreasing as long as the proportion of infections decreases. And then we finally have the recovered, which is the number of infected that are recovered, basically, okay? So times the rate of recovery. So then we ask the function to return a list with these values. That would be a data frame with three columns, the susceptible, the infected, and the recovered, along with time. And so this is the function I like to talk about, basically. So my question is, do you have a different way to do this bit, which is the core of the function? So basically, not using with. Okay. So I think this is, yeah. This is very neat way to do this model. These are differential equations. So DS or DI and DR, I don't know if you know anything about those things, I believe so, but is intended as how the parameter S changes, for example, within the length of time. So in mathematics, for example, you use that. Let's see if I can do this. Like when you do ds divided by dt. So this is a differential equation. No? So now here in the function for making this differential equation, we don't use divided by dt. I don't know if you understand my questions or the point I'm trying to make. I don't know if it makes sense. Basically, if I had to do this function myself, no, I would have thought I need to do differential equation. So I would need dt as well. Instead, I don't need to use it. Because the function then spread all the result in a data frame. Each value of the time. So I show you if I go back to R. Does it make sense? A bit, okay, so let's loading these two libraries and then have the population, the state values, the parameters, then the time, and this is the function. So, okay, so this is a function. If I click on the function, see model, it releases all that is inside the function. So I can see how it's made. Then I do, I would use this function inside another function, which is ode, and this ode is from the solve package, this one here. If I run this function, I can see okay. If I run this old function, you see what it does is providing a data frame with a vector with the time, the susceptible, the infected, so the proportion of all my state values. Okay, then we get I wanted to go inside this function, okay? So because this function solves the differential equations, these things here. But my initial question, and then I don't ask anymore. Perhaps, do you have an idea on how to make this thing differently without using weight as list, even if then I require a list? I don't know.
I'm not sure about that, but would there be any reason that your function would like throw an error if you give it the wrong values?
Okay. But, you know, I would if you think that this is very neat, it's very nice, so simple, straightforward, few lines, it's done. Okay. So let's go back to our presentation and see now that we have this SIR model function, we put the function inside here, this other function. This other function will calculate, as I said, the differential equations. Okay, and this is a spec of the result. So we can have a look at it. So we can do like question mark, the solve ode. And if I go back to R, where is it? And I do this. It gives really some explanation about what this function is. It's a general solver for ordinary differential equations. Can you see my R enough big, or would you like me to put it bigger, increase the size maybe? Okay. So solves a system of ordinary differential equations. And it is a wrapper around the implementation of the other solvers. So it gives some explanation, say the methods for solving this differential equation. There are quite a few. That's Euler, 23, 45, Radu, Adams, Impact Adams. So quite a few different methods. So like very broad, it's able to catch different type of data. How does it do? Okay, so if we do dissolve order with three dots, or even just dissolve order like this. I don't know, I didn't catch very well what is the difference, because they release the same result. So if I do two dots or three dots, so if I do three dots, I can go inside the function. No? So in this case, this dissolve package with the odd function lets me get inside a bit of the function, because I'm not sure how you can hide things for others to see, to do not see. So this is a function which, and you can see what are the parameters of the function. You can even specify a method. If you don't specify a method, the method, there is some method as a default. Then it said set different cases. If you choose a method, if you do not choose the method, what it will do in other cases. So switching between methods. Okay, but can you see, so he uses a method, so then you need to get inside to find what the method does effectively. You cannot see it in the function. Then what else you can see are the bytes. And Ryan, for example, knows a bit about what is this, because we talked about on another book club about the dimension. So the space that occupies the function occupies in your computer when it gets working. And then specify that it comes from dissolve package. So all of this can be seen with the three dots. Then what's happened? If I do methods odd, it says something like it appears not to be an S3 generic function, and this is not clear. Then it demands you to search for more help with this way, no? Then you do this way, and quite generic. It's a list of methods for S3 generic function or classes. It's quite some explanations. And then I show you with another function what we can do with methods. But, it's a bit bug, let's say that. So if we go back to the presentation, okay, so we now have an idea what's odd is inside. Not very much sure, so I'm not satisfied to be honest, but at least I have an idea that something happened, switching between methods, returns an output, but I don't know. Then appears not to be an S3 generic. Okay, let's go forward with the model. Yeah.
Federica?
Yeah.
Sorry, I wanted to jump in right there. I apologize. Do you mind going back to R real quick? And I'll highlight one of the points that I had made last week or the week before regarding the dispatch system. So at the very top, if you notice, after the function declaration, you have two if statements. So if is null method, and then method equals, is it LSODA? And then if is list, and then it calls in the method, if inherent method, RK method. What I wanted to highlight, those two if statements, I was discussing last time about S3 versus S4 and the management between the two of them, on. But the idea behind that is that dispatching call, like what is our media that we're working with, and then how does the function appropriate process that data. So dependent, going back to Trevin's question earlier about the error within the function itself. So we're creating a function and we're passing in a subfunction underneath it, yada yada. Trevin asked if what would happen if we give it erroneous data, like we try to process something that doesn't work. Well, to Trevin's question, that those two if statements are actually where that method management comes in. So the dispatching or the environment, maybe I'm using that term incorrectly, as the media is ingested, processed, and it hits those two logic points, yeah, it's going to dispatch which form of that function it's required to have. Does that help answer the question maybe? Or I got excited when I saw the two F statements, it started to make sense.
Yeah. Yes, it makes sense because it makes sense. But you see, this is the function, homemade function. Okay. So when you call the function like this, simply just naming the function, you can see clearly what the function's doing. Okay, this is not such as complicated, so there's not many switching things, cases that you can use and then switch on the others, etc. But I believe that this is very more complicated, but there are other functions inside, and my question is there something hiding? There's more? I don't know. But anyway, there is a reason because I'm saying this. Let's go forward with this, our model, which is ended basically, because that's the function. So this is the output, and we now, this is our output, okay, that we made with the other function, this one here that we have just seen it. Now we use another function, and this function is a function which does something that we, or at least I know very well, because it behaves just as the same as pivot longer, okay? So the pivot longer. So instead we use the melt function from reshape to. Okay, as you can see, I melt the output and then I set an ID with the time, and I have basically done a pivot longer on my data frame, setting an ID equals to time. So the result is this. Then I looked at the same thing with the pivot longer function. And you have the output, you do the pivot longer for the columns like that, names to variable, values to values, and then you arrange the chain to variables. So this way, in a way that you have SIR. Okay, and this is the same output as melt, exactly the same thing. So now, before to proceed, because at the end I have a visualization, I left just a few minutes, but we like to see what this MELT function does, okay? So what instrument we can use to see inside the function and understand how it works. So using just the function name MELT as we did it before, or use structure inside MELT with MELT as an argument, we obtain the same output. So this is the output of the MELT function. So you cannot see you cannot see inside. You can see use method MELT. This is a method. Just as the other methods, the other function used, the function use different methods. Now this is a method MELT, which is melting, molting the data. You can see the bytes, you can see the namespace, so from which package it's from, but you can see nothing else. Okay, so I've tried body melt. You can see just use method. I tried foremost melt, and you can see now removes. Okay, this would make sense. You have some values, but it doesn't say that applies if you go longer. You know, then you can see environment, you have this namespace, okay, then type of closure. Within the brackets, this means that a function will work just when you call it. So it's our function simulate a closure by keeping an explicit reference to the environment that was active when the function was defined, not before, not after. So just when the function is defined, so it lets you in basically, no? So this means as a closure. Even the order function is a closure, is a type closure. But we want to get inside. So try with methods. Again, try with print method melt. It says the S3 method name is followed with an asterisk. So if I do method melt data, I can see what's inside a bit. So I can see the method. There is a melt array, but these are not the methods. So, or some sort of method. So basically it works differently if you provide an array, a matrix or a data frame, a table, or I don't know, melt default or a list. So with method melt data, you can see these things. But they, as you can see, they are all with an asterisk. So if you see an asterisk, that means that you cannot access the source. So okay, so what if I do class table to see, for example, I can see this bit here, what means. So I can imagine that as well is coercing, so forcing different things, but nothing else. This is the only thing I can see. And they are all with an asterisk, so this means that if the method definition is not exported from the package namespace, I cannot see inside. Okay, what can I do to see inside? Okay, I can do get anywhere. If I use get anywhere to one of the asterisk object, like, I don't know, melt data frame, do get anywhere melt data frame, I can see something. You see? So it's a single object, an S3 method, and now it's 9 p.m. So it's time. So basically, I haven't finished, and the best part is has to come. But anyway, these were my questions. On top of this, there is a bulletin from our help desk, which I put in the chat, and which tells you something about how to get inside a function. And I put this, as soon as this will be available. Why it doesn't, okay. You find it on GitHub. Then I'll put it on Slack, let's say that, okay. Let's go forward, and I finished. Then we may get on Slack and talk a bit more about that. So basically, then having melt the output, we now set a proportion to see what the values are in proportion and do a visualization of the infected, and then for the three compartments or the components of the model. So that's it. And about the bulletin, it's very interesting because it shows you a few interesting things about how to get inside. So I put this on Slack.
Frederica, as a general question to the team, has anybody else read those R News articles at all? I've only recently discovered some of the media that's inside, and it's extremely welcoming. Because the team, the R Studio team, answers a lot of questions, or even the R group answers a lot of questions regarding particular details. So if you're searching for anything and you ever see one of those pop up into your search history or looking for anything, it's definitely worth the pause and read through it. It may be a little bit more abstract than is required. Maybe it may not give you the exact detail you're looking for, but it'll definitely point you in the right direction. So.
Yeah, the bulletin is quite old because it's from 2006. I believe that in mentioning the second R Studio conference, but it provides the information. I found it on a Stack Overflow article. So, yeah. Okay, so I'm really sorry if I've taken a few more minutes out of the hours. We meet, we don't meet next week, but the following, with Trevin presenting chapter 7. We catch up on Slack with few resources and maybe going forward with the discussion, because I really like, I don't know, like talk about a different way to make this function. And I wish you all well. And if I don't see in person, Ryan, I'll see you the following week. Okay. Have a nice night. Night week.